Okay. Well, when I talked about hemoglobin, I talked about cooperativity, and I talked about something called the sequential model. We can talk about that with enzymes too. That is, that the binding of one thing affects the binding of other things. We can see a cause and effect. In the case of oxygen binding to hemoglobin, binding of one oxygen had the effect of changing the affinity of binding of hemoglobin for other oxygens. And so the sequential model can also be relevant for enzymes, because enzymes, like hemoglobin, can also have multiple subunits. Okay? So what I'm getting ready to describe to you is the phenomenon of allosterism. In allosterism, enzymes are having their activity changed as a result of binding of another molecule. Now, the models I'm going to talk to you about here relate to cause and effect, at least if we're talking about the sequential model. In the sequential model, there's a cause and effect. So a really good example I talk about from class is the enzyme ATCase. ATCase binds to a substrate known as aspartate. And when it binds to aspartate, it can change from the R configuration, or from the T configuration into the R configuration, and the binding of that substrate will have an effect on the overall activity of the enzyme. So the sequential model is one way of explaining how that happens. But there's another way of explaining how enzymes change as a result of binding to things. And that's something known as the concerted model. The concerted model is shown here. The concerted model is intuitively a little harder to understand, but I'm going to try to do that for you here. Remember that we have a T state and an R state. That's true for hemoglobin. That's also true for enzymes. Enzymes that are in the T state are less active. They catalyze less efficiently, they're slower, they don't do very well. Enzymes in the R state, on the other hand, catalyze reactions very effectively. And so we have the same analogy, tight, doing very little, R state, doing a lot, okay? Well, in the sequential model, there was a cause and effect. Binding of something caused the T state to change into the R state. But the other model, and this is oftentimes used to explain ATCAs, is called the concerted model. It's also called the M as in Mike, W as in White, C as in Charlie, MWC model. That and the concerted model called the same thing. That model says that there's not a cause and effect. The reason that the enzyme changes from the T state to the R state is because that flipping happens all by itself. But what keeps the enzyme staying in one state or the other depends on the molecule that it binds to. So in the case of ATCase, which binds to several things, let's think about the binding of ATCase to CTP. CTP is an inhibitor of the enzyme. On the other hand, ATP is an activator of the enzyme, okay? Let's forget aspartate for the moment. We've got CTP versus ATP. Well, if we were thinking about it in terms of the sequential model, we'd say, well, ATP causes it to go into this R state. But we know that doesn't happen here, okay? Instead, what we see is that ATP binds to the enzyme and holds it in the R state. So the enzyme is flipping back and forth between R state and T state, but the binding of something can hold it in that state. ATP activates the enzyme because once it holds it into that state, all of the enzymes eventually get into that state because as they flip into the R, an ATP binds to them and holds them in that state. So the enzyme gets activated because more of them are held in the R state than normally would be the case. On the other hand, CTP inhibits the enzyme. And it doesn't inhibit it by binding to it and causing it to turn into the T state, but rather because the enzyme flips back and forth between the T and the R state. When it flips into the T state, if it binds to CTP, that now holds it in that state. So the more CTP you have, the more enzyme will be held in the T state.